This podcast is part of Pearson's professional development series for reading and writing instructors.
I'm Peter Adams, and for the past 35 years, I've been teaching English, mostly developmental writing, at the Community College of Baltimore County. And it's become fairly common knowledge now among people who've been laboring in the developmental writing, the basic writing field for as long as I have, that this enterprise that we've been engaged in my case for 35 years, has not been nearly as successful as we had all hoped it would be. At my school, I did a study in 1993 that determined that only about 33% of the students who started in our upper-level developmental course ever completed English 101, never mind completed college, the goal we're all being pressed on these days. And so we've developed a program to address that problem. But to address it, we first had to figure out, why is it that all these students don't complete developmental writing? And it seems to us that we base this on surveys that we've done of students at the beginning of every semester, and we ask them, if you should have to drop out before the semester is over, what would be the most likely cause? And we give them a list of about 25, I think it's up to 30 now, different causes that other students have suggested. And we ask them to check as many as apply. And you know, as English teachers, we thought some students would say, oh, I always have trouble with fragments or comma splices or writing a unified essay with a clear thesis. And that's not why people drop out. That's not why we lose our students. It's because of life. It's because they're evicted from their apartment. They're in an abusive situation at home. They have trouble with the law. They have their children get sick and so forth. And then sometimes it's troubles in their heads, that is, that they lose confidence. They feel just so stressed out that they can't continue. And so we've developed a program that actually doesn't do any better of a job on comma splices and sentence fragments than anybody else's program does, but does try to attack some of those issues for students, some of those life issues and affective issues. We call the program the Accelerated Learning Program. And here's how it works. When a student arrives and is assessed and placed in developmental writing, they're told that they can take our traditional developmental writing course. And if they pass it in a semester, they can take English 101, the credit English class, the next semester. Most students aren't particularly receptive to that news, and in fact, many of them are downright hostile about it. My English teacher always told me I was a good writer. But we now have this ALP option, Accelerated Learning Program, and so we tell them about that as well. Under ALP, a student whose placement is developmental writing, the upper-level developmental writing course, is told that there are designated sections of the credit writing course of English 101 that they can take. And if they go the ALP route, and so let's say a typical student does choose to sign up for one of these 101 ALP sections, there she would be joined by seven other developmental students, so a little cohort of eight developmental students and 12 101 level students. Our class size is 20. We're very fortunate on that. And a teacher, of course. And then the same semester that little developmental student would also register for a developmental course that meets in the hour after the credit course. And the seven other developmental students would go with her to that class, and the same instructor. So those eight developmental students and that instructor spend 6 hours a week together, sort of like a learning community, only there's only one teacher involved. And half of the time that they're meeting, the developmental course time, is in a very small section of just eight students. We've settled on the number eight. Most schools that have adopted our program have adapted it and have a somewhat larger section, maybe 10 or 12 students. We think it's important in the 101 class that at least half the students be developmental. Well, the result of this program is that we have, for eight consecutive semesters now, we've been finding that 65 to 66 to 67% of the ALP developmental students actually pass the developmental course, take the credit course, and pass the credit course. In other words, we've doubled our success rate from something in the low to mid 30s to something in the mid to upper 60s. The first semester we ran this program, we couldn't believe the data. It was so, there was such a dramatic improvement in success rates. But now that it's been confirmed semester after semester, we're just elated with the results. Now, there are a lot of innovative approaches. Then ours is one, and there are compressed models and summer bridge models and learning communities and student success courses. There are lots of other programs that I think are also very useful. I'm going to talk for just a second about the state of developmental education. I'm making this podcast on the 23rd of February, and I just looked in online this morning and read a story that the state legislature in Connecticut has a bill that is widely supported and may pass to abolish developmental education in the state of Connecticut. I don't know if that'll pass or not, but I mention that because I think developmental ed is at a very precarious point. And that is, there's lots of data. The Community College Research Center at Columbia has done a wonderful job of opening our eyes to the fact that what we've been doing all these years hasn't been very successful. But they've also opened the politicians' eyes. And this is also a time of great financial shortages in state and local governments. And so if there is a part of higher ed that isn't producing very good results, and if it's a time of financial austerity, people are going to think about cutting developmental ed. I hope they don't do it in Connecticut. I think it'd be a huge mistake. But the reason I mention this is that programs like ALP and the other innovations that I talked about a minute ago are crucial in these times. My guess is that if we don't get it right, if we don't show dramatic improvements in the success rates of our developmental programs in the next 5 years or so, that there will be movements to abolish developmental ed across the country. And that would be just a criminal activity. It would mean tens of thousands of students would not have a shot at higher ed. One other thing about innovations is that there have been a number of them that have come up in the last decade or so, some directly affecting developmental education and some less so. And one of the sort of complaints about them, in fact, there's an apocryphal, probably apocryphal story that Bill Gates said one time, you know, I don't understand higher ed. The schools start these wonderful innovative programs and they show some results. And if you go back 10 years later, that program is still running at that school, usually just involving a handful of faculty members, and it hasn't expanded. In the business world, if somebody invents the iPhone 1 year, by the next year, everybody has a smartphone on the market. And so they find it sort of frustrating to get innovations to replicate and to scale up and to affect enough students that they actually make a difference in the success of higher ed. We're very proud of the replication efforts we've made with ALP. There are 43 schools around the country that I'm aware of, there's probably some that I don't even know about, who have adapted ALP to their own local conditions, and we emphasize that. We don't want anybody to try to just take our program and put it down without any changes in their location. And at our school itself, we started with just 5 sections each semester. So the first year we ran 10 sections, 8 students in a section, so it was just 80 students. This year, we are running 80 sections per semester, 160 for the year, and we're accommodating over 1,200 students, and next year we're going to go up by another 40 sections each semester to 120. So both internally, it's scalable, it works, we can still afford to do it and so forth, and externally, because it's spread to 43 schools, and there are several states that are now considering adopting an ALP model statewide. So I love my program, ALP. I think it would be great if lots of schools would adopt it. But there are other innovations out there. I'd just like to close with this message, and that is we really need to bear down in the next few years and figure out how to do this better, partially for political reasons, but more importantly for our students, that if we are only if we're only successful with a third of our students, we really need to figure out how to do that better. Thanks for listening.
For more podcasts and other resources, please visit Pearson's Professional Development Community site at www.englishinstructorexchange.com.